But just to go back to this list, Jeffrey Toobin, in the history here, you know, we talk about the possibility of a suitor or, you know, or a Kennedy. This list was created to eliminate that possibility. This, the Federalists have been working at this.
I wrote a piece in the New Yorker about Leonard Leo, who was the executive vice president of the Federalist Society, who compiled this list. And, you know, Leonard Leo and the Federalist Society, you know, it's, and it's not just abortion. It's eliminating affirmative action. It's eliminating even the possibility of any sort of gun control. I mean, you think, you know, we talk about eliminating, you know, bump stocks, for example. I mean, you know, the current view in the conservative legal world is that you cannot regulate anything relating to guns. You know, the religion. You know, allowing a greater use of the death penalty. You know, and as you know, allowing religious people to exempt themselves from more and more government requirements. This is, you know, this is the agenda that these 25 judges were picked to advance.
And this is the problem with Trump outsourcing this to an ideological activist organization. The problem is the drift in the court, as Jeff, of course, well knows, that in the Heller decision, Scalia actually did explicitly say there was room for reasonable gun restrictions. And the problem is that even over just the period of the last 40 years, you had a centrist, center-right Republican tradition. They were conservative, but like Kennedy, they weren't necessarily dogmatic. And the court and the national unity in the court that the court can reflect depends on swing justices. And there used to be a lot of them that came from Republican presidents, from Nixon on. That tradition seems to have been decimated, and it's because activist groups have effectively hijacked or outsourced the process.
Look, and I want to make clear about one thing here. I'm so sorry. It's that, you know, the argument about whether this is a good or bad thing, that's a separate thing. This just is. I'm just trying to lay out the case for what is right now. This is the situation. This is the situation that Republicans have seized upon. They did it because they could over the last few years. And this is the situation that Democrats face right now. And it'll be very interesting to see. We talked about the red state Democrats, but they're, you know, I'm very curious to see where the energy in the Democratic Party will go and how they will play on this issue. David Challey, maybe you've heard over the next several months.
Well, you saw the first thing out of the gate from every Democrat in your inbox yesterday was this should happen after the election. That just seems like a futile argument. I don't understand. But that's their initial organizing point. And they will make other ideological points to try and make the stakes, play clips of Jeffrey Toobin describing his vision of what may happen, and try to create some energy among their base. But again, to what end?
Yeah.
To Donald Trump getting his nominee on the United States Supreme Court.
It's also fascinating to look at it, you know, as you go through that list, and now you're looking at who's left, and the attention focusing more and more on John Roberts, and Jeffrey, I'll throw this to you, and how he does not want to see the Supreme Court, as we know, become more and more political, and yet, with this nominee, that's a tough thing to avoid.
Right. Well, you know, I acknowledge that John Roberts does not like this kind of role for the Supreme Court.
Yeah.
But he also has a vote. And, you know, there is going to be a statute that comes before, you know, from the state of Mississippi that says abortion is illegal in the state of Mississippi. And John Roberts is going to have to vote on whether that's whether that is constitutional or not. And I don't think there's any doubt about how he's going to come out on that. So, you know, yes, John Roberts would prefer that the court sort of go about its business in a quieter way. But, you know, too bad. That's not how the cases that come before the Supreme Court. And you know, the activists who bring these cases are going to bring these cases, and the Supreme Court can only duck so many of them.
David, Mitch McConnell. Cocaine Mitch, as he was referred to in West Virginia, is really Champagne Mitch this morning. He won. He won, and there's not even big enough three letters, W-O-N, to describe what he did here.
I couldn't agree with you more, and I think it was also very shrewd on McConnell's part. So not only did he win and the holding of the Garland thing, which enrages Democrats that may be. Again, what is, it does enrage Democrats. But the other thing that I think Mitch McConnell did that was really politically shrewd, he went nuclear, making it that you only need the 51 votes to get somebody onto the Supreme Court for the easier, lower stakes Gorsuch substitute for Scalia pick, right? A solid conservative for a solid conservative. If Mitch McConnell was trying to change Senate rules now over the replacement of Kennedy, there would be a much bigger fight. He would still be able to do it, don't get me wrong.
Right.
But there would be more backlash on that. He did it in the lower stakes one, and now it's poised to get somebody through with just Republican votes.
Just so much for being, you know, the institutionalist that McConnell pretends to be here. I mean, let's just call the hypocrisy out. This is cocaine and champagne Mitch. I mean, he's on a bender. The institutionalist argument's done. He gutted it the last time around, and that's what's going to make this next nominee possible.
The strong do as they will, and the weak suffer and as they must. Jeffrey, you're nodding. I want to give you the last word here just to make you feel better.
I feel fine. You're rocking the Thucydides, man.
I know.
You know, Chris Cuomo didn't do any Thucydides.
He's the perfect example of the weak suffering as they must. All right.
I think that should be the last word.
David Chalian and Jeffrey Toobin, thanks so much for being with us. Cuomo is still asleep.
He's got a DVR. Look out.
He doesn't know how to use it, though.
Or he might already be at the gym. Yeah.